So classification of dystonia is often thought to be a very dry, not very helpful topic. But classification is actually very important. It means that when one neurologist has seen a patient with dystonia, if they're writing to a neurologist even on the other side of the world, they'll both understand what the problem is, what they're talking about, and there's some very important issues. The other important aspect about dystonia is not one thing. It's really a collection of similar conditions which produce the same product of involuntary sustained muscle spasms, but often have very different biological pathways underlying them. So we're talking about a sort of collection of similar conditions. When we talk about classification, what we're really doing as neurologists is we're putting down in paper and pencil or on a page what we're observing. And so we get some very important bits of information: the age with which an individual develops dystonia, the course of that dystonia, has it got worse? Does it come and go? And there are some very rare conditions called paroxysmal dystonias where people are absolutely normal in between and then they'll develop brief spasms which can last for minutes or even hours. And those are referred to the paroxysmal dystonias. And they're very rare conditions and actually in some respect quite separate to most types of dystonia. We also want to know how much of the body is involved. So we describe which parts of the body are involved in dystonia and how they respond. Does it get worse as the day goes on? So we get lots of other information. But one of the key points about classification is it just dystonia? Are the only symptoms due to the muscle spasms, or are there other features? If it's just dystonia and there's nothing else, we refer to it now as isolated dystonia, and that's what used to be called primary dystonia. If they have other features, so they can have other neurological features, they can have jerks, which we call myoclonus, and there's a condition called myoclonus dystonia, they can have associated Parkinson's features, or they can have epilepsy or other more complicated features, even affecting other organs of the body, then we refer them to as complicated. And that's what used to be called secondary dystonia. The reason for knowing this is that they often have very different underlying causes. And probably if you look at all the different forms of dystonia, around 70% are isolated or primary, and about 20-25% are secondary or complicated. The complicated ones often have more serious brain problems where there are brain cells dying off, what we call neurodegeneration, or they can have inherited disorders of metabolism which present in childhood. Although some of the conditions such as myoclonus dystonia doesn't have any of those, it just has the myoclonic jerks and dystonia. And there's also other conditions, there's dopa-responsive dystonia, which is a very important condition to recognise, even though it's rare, because we can treat it very well, where they can have features of Parkinson's as well. And indeed, there's yet another condition called Dystonia Parkinsonism, where you have features of both Parkinson's disease and dystonia. So we separate them into isolated and into complicated, and then the next layer of classification is what's causing it. And sometimes that can be due to genetic factors, sometimes that can be due to environmental factors, and sometimes because there's actually an additional neurological process going on. So that's really how we break down the classification, and it's designed really for the clinicians so we can understand exactly what someone's seen, and if we describe it, they'll know what we're talking about. It's a little bit clunky, it makes it difficult for the layperson to understand, but unfortunately classifications are often that way, and this is one that's evolved over decades and currently is the one we use when we're describing and treating different forms of dystonia.